knowing your time, how do you know when your season of opportunity comes? How do you know when it's your time? Is it simply because you have declared that it is so by the word of your mouth and you expect it to be such? Or is there actually a season for success? Is there a season for failure? Is there a season for learning? Is there a season for leading? Is there a season for planning and executing those plans? So how do we know where we stand and what to do in this reality of, as scientists would put it, the space-time continuum? How do you view your present season of reality? How do you know when it's your time? This is Andre Knight with the word of life for your soul. Romans chapter 14, verse 2 to 3. For one believeth that he may eat all things, another who is weak eateth herbs. Let not him that eateth despise him that eateth not, and let not him which eateth not judge him that eateth, for God hath received him. Your present state of being is dependent upon your perception. If you have a negative perception of life, of things, of events, then your present state of being emotionally and spiritually is affected. So here we have two men, one who believes that he may eat all things. What, I can eat anything, is not going to make me sick. Another who says, hey, I am weak, I need to eat herbs. Let not him that eateth despise him that eateth not, and let not him which eateth not judge him that eateth, for God hath received him. And how do I take that? So if my good brother or sister here believes that they can eat certain things and it will not harm them, but if I believe that I will not eat certain things because it can harm me, who is right and who is wrong? And that question only has an answer within a context of you eating poison. So if you use poison, you will die. But there are things that are not poisonous intrinsically that would terminate your experience here on earth, that would take your life. But your system may not agree with it. And because your system does not agree with it, you say, hey, I can't eat that, I'll eat my herbs. But then there's the other person who says, hey, this thing is going to bother me whatsoever. And their mind takes over the situation. As the Bible says, a man thinketh, so is he. And they are not damaged by the very thing that will damage you. Do not be angry at God. The difference between you two is a healthy difference of perception. So if a man perceives the victory, he bends his energy to win. But if a man perceives defeat, he acquiesces. And therefore he is defeated. Notice in Romans chapter 14, verse 5 to 8. One man esteemeth one day above another, another esteemeth every day alike. Again, we have these two gentlemen. We have these two different perceptions. And what Paul is trying to get at is, do not allow another person's perception of reality to govern yours. Do not allow another person's relationship with God to govern yours. Do not allow another person's mental view of the matter to micromanage yours. To each his own. Govern yourself, govern your own life, govern your own experience. One man may see the stars in the sky up ahead. The next man may see the mud that they're standing in. Do not allow another person's perception to transform yours into something that is negative, because it hinders your relationship with God. So one man esteemeth one day above another, another esteemeth every day alike. Let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind. You govern your own reality. Be persuaded in your own mind. He that regardeth the day regardeth it unto the Lord, and he that regardeth not the day to the Lord, he doth not regard it. He that eateth to the Lord, for he giveth God thanks. And he that eateth not to the Lord, he eateth not, and giveth God thanks. For none of us liveth to himself, and no man dieth to himself. For whether we live unto the Lord, and whether we die unto the Lord. Whether we live therefore or die, we are the Lord's. Beloved, each man is living unto the Lord. So walk in your own integrity. Do not walk in another person's shadow. Do not allow another person's relationship, experience, prayer life to govern your own. Have yours. God is into organic relationships, because God has made you unique. He has given you a personality to express his divine character to others. So why we all have to come up to the one standard of the character of God as revealed in his law. He has given us personalities to express that divine character to others, that would attract the bees of this world, the wasp of this world, the birds of this world who need salvation. But if you're not being yourself, that means you're not standing in your lot. If you're not being who God has created you to be and expressing your personality as God has designed you to express, you're out of sync with the divine flow for your life, because you are there walking in somebody's shadow. Being a carbon copy or a 3D print of another man, it is unnecessary for your spiritual development, and it hampers it. It can be a hindrance to your salvation. Let us talk about time and chance. Ecclesiastes chapter 9 verse 11 to 12 says, I returned and saw under the sun that the race is not to the swift. Remember, our topic for discussion is knowing your time. And if in order to know your time, you have to know yourself. The first unique gift that God has given you is the first gift that God has given you is the uniqueness of your personality, how you express yourself. So one man may express himself in a particular fashion, another may express themselves in a particular fashion, but God has made you unique. Express yourself the way that God has designed. Be happy with who God has made you, your quirks, the pleasant ones, the benign ones, not the cancerous ones that attach themselves to our nature as a result of our fallen human natures that we possess. But there's a uniqueness in all of our personalities that is quite benign. That you know, hey, this is that person. And it is not offensive. That's just your signature. Understanding what are your signatures, understanding yourself, helps you in understanding the will of God for your life. It helps you in expressing or revealing the character of God to others in such a unique fashion that it draws a particular kind of person to Christ. So we are in Ecclesiastes chapter 9. I returned and I saw under the sun that the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, neither yet bread to the wise, nor yet riches to men of understanding, nor yet favor to men of skill. But time and chance happeneth to them all. Time and chance, beloved. What is time and chance that happens to all of us? So the race is not for the person who can run fast. The race does not go to the swift. The race does not go to the person with the longest legs and the thickest thighs. The battle does not go to the man who is strongest, who pushes the most weight or has the largest arms. Bread does not always go to the wise. Riches do not always go to men of understanding. Smartness does not equate to richness. Nor yet favor to men of skill. But time and chance happeneth to them all. Powerful. Time and chance happeneth to them also. How do we identify our time? First, know thyself, O man. Secondly, understand this divine principle. Time and chance happeneth to everyone. So therefore, what do we need to be aware of in order to know our time or know our blessing, our season of opportunity? We must understand the principle of time and chance. So what is time and chance? Time and chance can be summed up in one word, opportunity. So the swift will only win the race through opportunity. What is the opportunity? The opportunity to train and develop your muscles, train and develop your form, train and develop your sprint, your bursts, train and develop your breathing, opportunity to train and develop yourself, an opportunity to express this development, opportunity. Because there are people who have potential, but their opportunity is absent. And in impoverished societies, there are many people with opportunity, and there are many people with potential, but the opportunity is lacking to express that potential. Do you get it, beloved? So in your prayer life, ask God to help you understand your potential and give you opportunity to develop it and express it. Know how to pray. So time and chance is opportunity, beloved. That's an event, an occasion, or season of fortune and opportunity. That's what the original Hebrew said it is. An event. Time and chance happeneth to us all. An event, an occasion, or season of fortune and of opportunity. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, and we're going to read verse 1 to 11. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 1 to 11. To everything there is a season. So every day is certainly not going to be the same. You may have a group of days that are the same, But there's a season. And the seasons that we have on earth, depending on where you live, is wet season and dry season. Depending on where you live, the seas are rough or the seas are calm. Depending on where you live, it's winter, spring, summer, fall. Depending on where you live, there are days, months of sunlight or darkness, depending on where you live. So location determines season. You must understand this, beloved. Because based on your location, there are opportunities that will never be afforded you because that kind of season is not prevalent. Location. So once we are speaking about season, we automatically have to involve location. Where I'm at right now, the days are short, 6 to 8 hours of sunlight. Where other people are at right now, they have 12. Where other people are at right now, they have none. It's all about season. And when you talk about season, location. So if you're going to be present in your experience with God, if you're going to be present about your life, you must take into account the things connected with your location, the opportunities connected with your location. So in your location, how best can you grow, develop, and prosper and be in good health? In your location, how best can you work for God and build your life up? Because your location determines the season. So once you get the facts straight about your location, then you come to a clearer understanding of how the season, how your location affect the season, or your season affect the location, and how you can work within your season. Then you begin to pick up patterns, because seasons are patterns. A pattern, a climatic pattern, environmental stability or instability, but it's a pattern nonetheless. So to everything there is a season, or there is a pattern that comes in a particular fashion and it recycles. So once you get a firm grip on the cycles of life, because God is going to try you for a season. So you're going to go through a season of trials. But granted, if you go through a season of trials, it means you will go through a season of blessing. So when your season of blessing comes, just like in the 7 years of famine, the 7 years of abundance that led to 7 years of famine, so that was a season of abundance that prepared them for the season of famine. So, beloved, there are times in your life where things are coming at you in abundance. Opportunity. Opportunity to the left. Opportunity to the right. Opportunity coming at you so fast. It is overwhelming. You know what? Open your mouth wide that God may fill it and take it, because it is to fill your barns with plenty, set a foundation for you so that when the famine comes, you are straight. You are good. You are solid. So that when the opportunities come, they are only coming for a season. So they're very seasonal opportunities that come your way. Very seasonal. And because they are seasonal, take it, beloved. Stretch yourself. Grow. Build the barns of your mind. Build up your spiritual inventory. Build up your life. Build up your experience. because a famine comes. The trials come. So if you lay the foundation deep and you build the tower high enough, you can stock your soul, your spiritual inventory that keeps you in the time of drought. You can stock your life tangibly with the resources that you need, the connections that you need. Do not be the kind of person that put things off, that procrastinates, or that assumes erroneously so that, you know what, that opportunity that will come again, they will always be around. Oh no, beloved. Nobody will always be around. Because your handle is not on reality. Your handle is not even on your own life, because it can be snuffed out just like that. So when you understand seasons, you sit and you consider. You look at the patterns. You look at the cycles. You look at what is coming your way. What you can deal with reasonably. What you can stretch yourself to grow, because you can stretch yourself so that you can grow in the stretch, or you can stretch yourself that you can be destroyed and torn asunder by the stretch. So don't be greedy. Recognize your limitations. To everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven. A time to every purpose. There are purposes that need to be fulfilled, but there's a time period that are given them. Praise God that it is not always hurricane season. Praise God that it is not always winter. Praise God that it's not always summer. Praise God that it is not always drought. There's a time to every purpose. So if the drought comes, it's a time to every purpose. The land lies fallow. It's given, it may be dried up, but when the rains come, it springs to life again. There will be some mudslides, by the way. So if God is trying to clear an area and he brings it to drought and nothing grows on it, that soil becomes hard and caked and dry. When the rains come, it washes away that soil. God just wanted to wash away the soil. So he used the ecosystem to do his bidding. Because something that is underneath needs to be exposed. And God digs into our souls, our lives, our religious experiences in like manner. To everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven. Notice this principle, beloved. The Israelites at the borders of Canaan, they missed their season of deliverance through unbelief, through murmuring and complaining. And you know what? It was their season to go into the land of Canaan immediately. But because of unbelief, they missed their season, and it left them to wander for 40 years in the wilderness to that season return again. So you see, beloved, what I'm saying. A season. Opportunities come in season. The doors that open up in season, or as one of my favorite motivational speakers would say, you got to take advantage of the opportunity for the lifetime of that opportunity, because all opportunities are not for a lifetime, but you can have an opportunity of a lifetime. 40 years wandering in the wilderness, waiting for their season of deliverance and coming into the promises of God being fulfilled in their life to return to them again. And do you know what this shows? This shows that your perspective, your mindset, your personal belief about the situation affects whether or not the situation works out in your favor, even though it may be the will of God for it to work out. So your perception and your belief governs the will of God, because it was the will of God that they go straight into the land of Canaan. So don't give me those arbitrary excuses telling me that, oh, God was only testing them, but he really wanted them to wander in the wilderness for 40 years. No, he didn't. God is not pretentious, you see? And so God is real. He brought them to the borders of Canaan, and the situation tested their faith, and they did not realize that they did not have faith in, and there was no reason for them not to have faith, because they have just seen miracles. So God says, A, I just 10 plagues on Egypt. B, pillars of fire, pillars of cloud. C, cross the Red Sea. D, strike the rock. E, manna. F, quail. All kind of providence exercised on your behalf. So if you have seen all of this, then the next logical step is for you to believe, or for you to trust and say, you know what? It's a fearful thing that God is expecting me to do. I don't have the strength to do it, but you know what? Based on what he did for me in the past, I know that he will do. And I will repose my trust in that fashion. But they did not do that. Oh, we are as grasshoppers. The inhabitants of the land will eat us up. Oh, you fools, die in the wilderness. Your unbelief was unwarranted. And the season of opportunity, it closed. It went away forever. It went away for 40 years, but forever for those who did not believe. This is why Proverbs 18:21 says, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. So you're going to speak to life your thoughts. So you're speaking your faith, or you're going to speak your unbelief. When they spoke their unbelief, they died in the wilderness. Look at that, beloved. Your perspective of the situation, whether you esteem one day above another, whether you esteem all days as the same, whether you say, well, I can eat herbs because I'm weak, whether you say nothing is going to hurt me, therefore I can eat all things. Your perception governs your reality. It governs your experience as a Christian. It governs your relationship with God, even the promises of God being fulfilled in your life. You stop your own blessings if you have a faulty perception. To everything there's a season and a time to every purpose. Verse 2, it continues. A time to be born and a time to die. And I wanted to mention this as we were looking at Ecclesiastes chapter 9, where it says time and chance happeneth to them all. There's a time to be born and a time to die. So if you were born in the 50s, or the 60s, you would have been at the head of our modern day internet revolution. Internet and computer revolution. If you were born in the 1800s, like Carnegie and J.P. Morgan, you would have been at the head of the industrial revolution, where these men became powerful financial and business magnates and commanded large storehouses of money. So the time period that you are born in can determine the height of success that you can reach in any line. The time period is important. So there's a time to be born and a time to die. And I don't recall the names of all of them, but Bill Gates is Bill Gates, and he was able to be rich because of the time that he was born in. Warren Buffett as well, who's slightly older than Gates. Looking at these people's life stories. See, because where Mr. Gates is concerned, because of the year in which he was born, where he went to high school, at the onset of the internet and the computer revolution, where coding was now being built up and learning to code and build and develop software and programs, the associations that his mother had, along with the opportunities it afforded him as a result of her associations. The school that he was at was the perfect foundation for him to be who he was. He was born at the right time and in the right place. This is what Solomon says, time and chance. So it's not that he was better or more smarter than you. It was that time and chance, and he was born at the right time for the right thing in the right with the right opportunity. So many great men of today were born, came into this world at the right time, and the right opportunities were given them. And boom. And that is a principle that governs our life. So ask God. So you just need to sit down and reflect about the time that you are living in and how you can capitalize on the time for your personal and spiritual development. And this is a wonderful time for spiritual development, but it's also a challenging time for it as well. Wonderful because we have technologies to help us on our spiritual journeys, and challenging because we have technologies to detract us from the straight and narrow path. And so these two are going in tandem. But we are living in an information age where we can go, where knowledge is open to us, and that we can have a clarity of understanding about God, His will for our life, have a more balanced perspective right now because of information, but in tandem with it, because there's so much information, we can become scattered. So the age of books, the 90s, and the 80s and the 60s and before, the age of books, where the information after was made known to man after the Dark Ages, and the printing press was invented as a result of the Reformation, and the age of books being printed. You know, that was a prime opportunity. And to have those books on hand to read and study off, perhaps that was a better time. You have to know for your own soul. But when you make a decision in understanding who you are and how God expects you to express yourself and develop yourself, you will come to a point of peace. But there's a time to be born, because each time is not the same. Each age is not the same. This is now the age of stupidity. Because the more wiser and advanced and progressive man gets, the stupidness that we are hearing in this world right now, it is unparalleled. It has now surmounted the ignorance of the Dark Ages. The stupidity has now surmounted ignorance. This is the time of the fool and not the wise. The fool is reigning. Or at least foolishness or foolery, whatever have you. So there's a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up that which is planted. So there's a time to plant seeds. And you know, sometimes in dealing with people's souls, in dealing with people as they interact with you, because Proverbs tell us that he that winneth souls is wise, and each soul that is won, that's a star in your crown. And there will not be a person in the kingdom of heaven who has not won somebody to Christ. And sometimes we sit down and we think, how is that possible? Does that mean I have to be with that person from the start of their questioning of the reality of God and his claims upon their life to the time they get into the watery grave of baptism? No, but God brings you in people's pathways, either to plant, either to water, but he gives the increase, or either to harvest. So there's a time to plant and a time to pluck up that which is planted. So there are things that are, and as you look at life, sometimes you see some flowers or fruit trees specifically growing in the wrong location. They don't belong in that location, and they need to be plucked up and transplanted. And this is the sad reality for so many lives. This is where we have immigration all over this world, because people are born in some very disturbed places on earth, and they need to be plucked up and planted other places that they can grow and develop. So there's a time to plant and a time to pluck up that which is planted. Notice this. There's a time to kill and a time to heal. I always hear people speak virtuously of others. Oh, he would not hurt a fly. Let me tell you something about me. I will hurt flies. I will hurt ants. I will hurt rats. I will hurt roaches. I will hurt snakes. I will hurt dogs. If they attack my children, you think I'm going to stand up and value the life of that animal be above my children? No, I will not, because animals, while I do not believe in torturing, beating animals, I would not allow them to harm my children. Because animals cannot change their own destiny. Neither can animals invent. They can give me emotional comfort. They can give me assistance. They can help me to accomplish work. They are helpers, but they are not change agents. Neither are they inventors. They are not masters of their own destiny. They are not. As talented as they are not masters of their own destiny. So if it's attacking my children, will I stand up there and value the life of an animal above my children? No, I will stop it from harming my children, come what it may. Because it's a time to kill and it's a time to heal. So I hear people talk because, and they do not have an experience with reality, because they live in sheltered, sterile environments. But when you live in the real, and you're seeing hordes of ants, because the rain has just fallen for days, and these hordes of ants leave their nests and they're rushing to your home. Oh, it's God's creatures. God did not design them to be pests, or to be a plague. So at the point of them being a plague, no, you draw the line. But I have never heard a person say, look at a centipede and say, hey, that's God's creature. No, they always say that's the devil. I digress, beloved. A time to kill and a time to heal. So on many islands in the Caribbean, there were overpopulation of snakes. The Philippines as well, there were overpopulation of rodents, and they brought in birds to kill the rodents. Or they brought in mongoose to kill the rodents, to kill the snakes, to depopulate the thing that was causing a problem. So there's a time for everything. A time to break down and a time to build up. So there's a time, beloved. So what time is it in your life? What time were you born in that helps you to determine the extent or the limitations of your growth, development, or opportunity? What has been planted within your soul, or what has been plucked up? Are you living where you were planted, or are you living where you were replanted because you have to be plucked up? Or do you recognize that you may need to be plucked up? Many people said, hey, look, and this is the same biblical principle. Many people say, I was born here and therefore I would die here. Bless God. That is good for them. But that is not for me. I was planted here, I was born here, yes. But for my tree and my fruit, I need to be plucked up at this time and replanted someplace else. So you govern your own reality and do not allow other people to govern yours. So if you believe that you are born here and you will die here, listen, stick to it. That is wonderful, because your opportunities may be different to somebody else's and everything may be working out for you here. But for others, that may not be the case. A time to break down and a time to build up. So what is God breaking down in your life and what is God building up? Where are you? Are you at the breaking down stage? Or are you at the building up? Because remember, these things come in season. So there's a good season to be born. There's also a good season to die. There's a good season to plant. And a good season to pluck up that which is planted. It's a season to kill. So again, if you have an overpopulation of a menacing creature, rodents, snakes, whatever, it needs to be controlled, so that is killing season for that. Where the numbers will be preserved in the right quantities, and this is where you have hunting seasons. All over the world, in different localities, for different creatures, because the creatures have a tendency to proliferate at a particular time. So what season are you in your life, beloved? Are you in the breaking down? Or are you in the building up? There's a time to weep and a time to laugh. So there's a time for all of these things. Therefore, we must recognize that it is good to weep and it is good to laugh. But do not laugh when it's time to weep. There's a time to mourn and a time to dance. So yes, there's a time to experience the somber reality of your human frailty as we mourn and consider death and life. It keeps us present in the moment. It keeps us very present when we consider death, because we appreciate the life that we still have and the opportunities that can still be afforded us. A time to mourn and a time to dance. And I love it. So he didn't pair a time to mourn with a time to laugh. Is this a time to weep? Yes, and it's a time to laugh. And there's a time to mourn where you are physically depressed. But then there's a time to dance where you are physically joyful. So he's taking you from one extreme to another. Experiencing the bones of and the depths of our emotional possibilities, mourning and dancing, because happiness is associated with dancing. Let it out. So there's a time to put your hair up and there's a time to let it down. And when it's time to let it down, don't be a stiff, beloved. Be real. This is what it means to be real. Enjoy. Verse 5, a time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together. And I love this. Why do I love this? See, because accumulation must always be balanced with decluttering. You can accumulate things. You can accumulate friends. You can accumulate acquaintances. And these things can crowd your life. You can gather these stones together. But if you gather them, they're time that you don't want every stone. Cast it away. So declutter your friend circle. Declutter your home. Declutter your associations. Declutter your goals, because there are some goals that, whatever. Declutter your bucket list too, because there are some things, if you consider, you know what? The thing that I want to do before I die may very well cause my death. So you know what? I'm cool. I'll change that. Everything, beloved, is not always worth keeping around all the time. So you might gather some stones together, but you know what? Cast some of them away. There's a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. So don't let anybody fool you. Oh, you are a Christian. You should love everybody all the time and hug everybody all the time and show them a smiley face all the time. No, we're going to see in this very text that, you know what? That is pretensiveness. God has never caused you to be pretensive. There are times where people need to see your face dark and cloudy like a thunderstorm, so that the fear of God can enter their heart, because they've been riding over you, taking advantage of you and maligning you. So it can't always be a smiley face. That's unbiblical. That is pretensive. God has not called us to be a mannequin. Just keep it real. So there's a time to embrace, and there's a time, now I'm not going to hug you, because you're going to take my hug to you as consent to your actions that you know that I hate. Or that is wrong. So there's a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. Open rebuke, Solomon said, is better than secret love. There's a time to get and a time to lose. There's a time to keep and a time to cast away. Beloved, where are you? This is the beginning of a new year. Where are you? Are you keeping things that you need to cast away? Are you losing when you should be getting, or getting when you should be losing? Losing is not always negative. They may interpret it as, but there are things that we don't need as baggage. Lose some weight in your life. And I don't mean physically. A time to get and a time to lose. A time to keep and a time to cast away. Those, beloved, those men who are on the stock market, those people, rather, who are savvy investors, they understand this principle. And they understand it clearly. There's a time to buy that stock. There's a time to sell that stock. You watch the market. You watch the trends. You watch the seasons. So we as God's people must be aware of the ebb and flow of the varying tides of society and the rise and fall of institutional power and personal power. The rise and fall of game changers, deal makers, the rise and fall of opportunity. We must be aware for it, beloved. Verse 7 says there's a time to rend and a time to sow. As I said earlier, you know what? Every connection, friendship, or association is not always profitable for your soul for the long term. There are things that you have in your life that you don't need there forever. Don't be a hoarder. Hoarders are those who want to get, but they don't want to lose. Who want to gather stones, but they don't want to cast them away. They're those who they're sewing up, but they don't tear. They're just keeping, but they're not casting away. So every connection in your life, beloved, every friendship or association, is not always profitable for your soul for the long term, you know. Because if Proverbs 27:24 says, hey, look, riches are not forever, and they make themselves wings and flying away, that's Proverbs 23:25. Riches are not forever, and of the crown endure to every generation. No, riches are not forever. Then 23:25 says they make themselves wing and fly away. Everybody knows this. Come the end of the month, the end of the week, whatever the case is when you're paid, it came with a pair of eagle wings, all of your money, and it flew right out. Where is it? So if this is the case with the fundamentals of our reality, our existence, that we cannot operate without, which is money, then we must therefore understand that there are things, there are events, there are people who come into our lives for a season. They are there for a temporary basis. Even if they do or mean, they do the utmost good to you, or they mean the most to you, the world to you. They're just there for a short season. They're not there for the long term. Don't make the temporary experience a permanent one. Don't take a seasonal experience or a seasonal person in your life, don't make them a daily experience or a daily person. Some people are sweet as honey, but you can't drink a, you don't want a tablespoon or a cup of honey every day, don't you? So allow them to be for their season. As good as crutches are, if your foot is broken, to help you to be mobile, once that foot is healed, that bone is healed, those said crutches will prevent you from walking properly and regaining your strength. Don't make the temporary experience permanent. Training wheels teach you to ride a bicycle. Get accustomed in being on a bicycle, to develop some sense of handling of it. But you know what? You got to take off those training wheels in order to learn how to balance that bike. So there's a time to rend and a time to sue, beloved. In order for your growth, you must understand this. Because when you make the temporary permanent, you don't recognize what really was to be permanent, who really was to be permanent. So understand. And there's some points that I can make. We are living in a time where the devil has artfully placed us in a position where our pasts catches up with us. Where people that passed through our life and they needed to remain in our past, and that is where they should be, they now can find us and be part of our life again and cause us to relive pain and be uncomfortable as though we never grew. Occupying your headspace. Poops, they're sending you a friend request. So if you are weak and vulnerable, there's no law or there's no reason for your emotional state that you have to press accept. You have the power to say, no, it's not like that. You remain in my past. Don't need you in my present. Don't need you to be spying on me, looking at me, having a window into my life. It's not yours, it's mine. That same verse 7 ends by saying a time to keep silence and a time to speak. And that is quite powerful because often we can say the right thing to the wrong ears. And there's much talk nowadays of speaking truth to power. But Proverbs 25:11 says that a word fitly spoken is like apples of gold and pictures of silver. So when we're talking about a time to keep silence and a time to speak, time, place, person, and intent must be taken into account. Time. Is it the right time for me to say what needs to be said? Where my voice will be heard and my protest registered? Place. Is it the right location and situations for me to give utterance to my concerns? Person. Is it the right individuals or group that I'm speaking to that have the power to do something about it or grant me the necessary support and give voice to my valid arguments? Because I don't know about you, beloved, but I'm tired of talkers. There are people that talk, oh, we should do this, we should do that, should. But when the action time comes, all you can hear are the crickets. Intent. Time, place, person, intent must be taken into account. So, am I seeking simply just to air my concern or grievance or observation? Am I simply venting? Are you simply venting, beloved? Or are you speaking, bringing a solution that can have a valid, game-changing effect that is actually a solution? So what's your intention? So there's a time to keep silence and a time to speak. And when we consider when to speak up, what to say, who to speak up to, who to speak up for, and for what reason, then our words would be as apples of gold in pictures of silver. Speaking is energy. You don't want to expend vital force in speaking and nothing happens. You want to be like a nail in a sure place. Now, verse 8 gets quite interesting, it does. And it says, there's a time to love and a time to hate. This can be a little nuanced. This can be a little misunderstood. Can love hate? Can hate love? God, who is the embodiment of love, the paragon of perfect love, God says that he hates sin. So if God hates sin, hate is not the opposite of love. But sin is. He hates that which is opposite of himself. He hates sin. God doesn't even hate Lucifer, but he says he hates things, and the things that he hates are based on the nature of sin itself. God is not full of hate. He doesn't hate a person. Even the demons of hell, the prince of darkness, still loves him. But his love does not prevent his justice, because Lucifer breached the bounds of God's mercy millennia ago. So can love hate? Is hate the opposite of love? No, sin is. So let me ask you a question. Do you love poverty? Because if you tell me that you love poverty, you can't understand what poverty is. You cannot understand what poverty does. You don't. You don't see it destroy lives if you tell me that you love poverty. You don't see it destroy lives, the unreached potential, the decrepit conditions that people exist in, the occult in existence. So do we love poverty? No. Do we love misery? No. We don't like them? No, I love them. Do we love suffering? No. But do we hate poverty? Do we hate misery? Do we hate suffering? Some people don't hate misery because their judgment is not as clean and clear on the situation or on the people that are causing them misery. They are conflicted. Oh, I love this person, but he makes me so miserable. And I don't know what to do because I know that I shouldn't entertain them. But because I love them, I do. But I am only reaping misery as a result. So when you're conflicted like that, it's because you love misery and you do not hate it. Because when you hate misery, you clarify, you're clear in your mind and thoughts and you recognize, hey, look, I love you, but I don't like what you do to me. I don't like the effect you have on my life. And I will no longer be in subjection to the spirit of misery. Therefore, you need to bounce, you need to walk, you need to step. I will have none of it any longer. So yes, we can become conflicted. And this is why I mentioned, God doesn't hate the sinner. He doesn't hate Lucifer or his demons of darkness, but he hates their sin that they indulge in and they cause people to commit. God is quite clear. You hate the thing, but not the person. So, are we going down the rabbit hole to say, is it always wrong to hate? No, because hate is simply a very strong, intense emotion or dislike for something. So it's not wrong to hate something, but it is dead wrong to hate someone. Because hate drives you to a series of actions that can cause death, to a life that you did not give. So Solomon identifies that there's a time to love, there's a time to hate. So there's a time to love within the context of, there's a time to embrace, to show appreciation and adoration, acceptance of a thing or situation or a person. But hate is a little more subjective. Some people hate bread. This is a generation where people hate bread, where people hate carbs. I am vegan for 20 years. I'm not vegan. I'm total vegetarian. Sorry. I'm total vegetarian for 20 years. I don't hate meat. I just made a choice. I am choosing a healthier option. Neither do I hate to see people eat it. No, I don't. I would rather they're not for health reasons. But that's what it is. So hate could be a little subjective. The hate of a person is a personal calamity that the devil successfully spurs on multitudes, beloved, in the indulgence of, and it manifests itself in many forms. Whether it's xenophobia, whether it's tribalism, whether it's classism, whether it's elitism, whether it's racism. Hate. But I'm not going down that political route. There is always some valid concern with caution as it relates to dealing with certain individuals, and you should exercise caution. So because there may be a time to love, it doesn't mean that you just accept people straight off of the bat just like that. No, you deal with people meritoriously. Let them earn your respect or and trust. Don't give it to them. In none of these I've seen that there's a time to just give away a trust without some person earning it. No. There's always a time to love. And we can love people at all times. But because we love people, it does not mean we accept, condone, or affirm their behavior. You can love them, but you can park them right in the corner. And you can allow them to suffer the consequences of their actions and not shelter them from that learning experience that is designed to develop in them a proper character, a more acceptable behavior. So love does not blind you to a person's faults, because God is not blind to Lucifer's faults and to the war that he has reaped upon the earth, havoc that he's wrought upon the earth. No, loves him, but he still will face judgment. So there's no hate of the individual in his love, simply of the thing that individual is doing that is wrong. There's no vitriol, there's no grudge, there's no nastiness, there's no spite where God is concerned. And we need to examine for ourselves how God loves, that we can do likewise. Now, there's always a time to love people in its most basic form of tolerance and respect, but a time to hate the despicable acts they may perform or the evils they perpetrate and the habits they indulge in that are pernicious. There's a time to express your adoration and appreciation and act accordingly, and a time to express your intense emotional dislike and act accordingly. So don't let people fetter you. No, there are things that you like and there are things that you don't like. No. I may not express that in every situation, in every place, but I will express it nonetheless, because no, I don't like it. There are things I just dislike. No, don't give me that. Don't want it. No, I can't eat rice every single day of the week. No, I don't like it. I don't hate the rice, but I don't like eating it all the time. No, don't do that. So I have strong dislike, but I don't hate it. So it helps you to put yourself in your emotional state in proper context. So the person who acts the same way on all occasions and is not moved to act accordingly to the situation may very well be indulging in some very pretentious behavior. And God has not called us to pretentiousness. See, because with God, there's no pretense. This would explain God's behavior and his anger over the Israelites' apostasy in making the golden calf and his desire to destroy them and blot them from the face of the earth. Because the situation merited it. The situation merited their anger. He had just cause and just reason to be angry at these people that he had just delivered by a mighty and outstretched arm and wonderful miracles from Egypt, who chose to go back to the idolatry that had them in bondage. He needed to be angry. Any other reaction from God would have been unacceptable, grossly inadequate. And then notice now Moses, quite distressed over it, and then had the audacity to ask God to blot his name out of the book of life if he's going to destroy these people. And you know what God did to Moses? Rebuke him. That was false sense of holiness, Moses. It's commendable to an extent, but it was pretension. It was false. Let us go to the text then. Exodus 32, verse 31 and to 35. And Moses returned unto the Lord and said, "Oh, this people have sinned a great sin and have made them gods of gold. Yet now, if thou wilt forgive their sin. So now he's trying to hold God ransom for these people. And if not, blot me, I pray thee, out of thy book which thou hast written. And notice God. And the Lord said unto Moses, whosoever have sinned against me, him will I blot out my book. So God is like, Moses, get your head straight. If you sin against me, I'm going to blot you out of the book. But these people sin against me. So guess what? Blot. Don't get in my way. Don't get caught under friendly fire. Therefore, now go and lead the people unto the place of which I have spoken unto thee. Behold, mine angels shall go before thee. Nevertheless, in the day when I visit, I will visit their sin upon them." So did God change his course of action? No, he delayed it. "You do not stop me from doing this because they qualified themselves for destruction. And my anger is still not turned away." Because God is not pretentious, there must be an emotional response that is evoked by us. And when I read, there's a time to love and a time to hear, it teaches me the lesson of being emotionally intelligent. And there are situations that merit our anger, that merit our disgust, that merit our compassion, that merit our warmth, that merit our joy and our gladness. And so, meritorious to the situation should be my response. Now, Deuteronomy 9, verse 11 to 20. "And it came to pass at the end of 40 days and 40 nights that the Lord gave me the two tables of stone, even the tables of the covenant." So he's recounting this experience. "And the Lord said unto me, Arise, get thee down quickly from hence, for the people which thou hast brought forth out of Egypt have corrupted themselves. They are quickly turned aside out of the way which I have commanded them. They have made them a molten image. Furthermore, the Lord spake unto me, saying, I have seen this people, and behold, it is a stiff-necked people. Let me alone, that I may destroy them and blot out their name from under heaven, and I will make of their nation mightier and greater than they. So I turned and came down from the mount, and the mount burned with fire, and the two tables of the covenant were in my two hands. And I looked, and behold, ye had sinned against the Lord your God, and had made you a molten calf. Ye had turned aside quickly out of the way which the Lord had commanded you. And I took the two tables, and cast them out of my two hands, and break them before your eyes. And I fell down before the Lord as at the first. 40 days and 40 nights I did neither eat bread nor drink water, because of all your sins which ye sinned in doing wickedly in the sight of the Lord to provoke him to anger, for I was afraid of the anger and hot displeasure wherewith the Lord was wroth against you to destroy you." So God was angry. "But the Lord hearkened unto me at that time also." So the Lord just delayed the judgment. "And the Lord was very angry with Aaron to have destroyed him. And I prayed for Aaron also the same time." So God was not only angry with the Israelites, he was angry at Aaron because his situation merited that anger, that displeasure, that intense emotion. Here it is called an intense emotion of dislike. He hated what Aaron did. He hated what the people did. So that was a time to hate. But he didn't hate the people, you know. He hated the sin. And so he hearkened unto Moses' intercession and gave them time. Aaron still was defrocked as a result, though. Consequence, when Moses struck the rock twice and not once, God did not like that. Moses died when he should not have died. He did not go into the promised land. So, consequence. So, you can love a person. You can hate something that they did. And there can be consequences to their actions. But it doesn't mean that you stop loving them. Never remove the consequence. When you remove the consequence of their action, you are establishing a temporary situation as a permanent one. You're gathering when you should be casting away. You are sewing up when you should be rending. That is a problem. You are keeping the season of drought present and not allowing it to go into the season of abundance. You are allowing the winter to remain and not allowing spring to come. So that statement ends with, there's a time to love, time to hate, a time of war, a time of peace. And verse 9 and 10, 9-11 says, what profit hath he that worketh in which weareneth he laboreth? I have seen a travail which God hath given to the sons of men to be exercised in it. He hath made everything beautiful in his time. So in God's time, he makes everything beautiful. All things work together for our good. And I will end there. And let me give you a parting thought. There are journeys we can embark on in our lives that are not of a physical nature. They are of the emotional, intellectual, and the spiritual kind, these journeys. And they can bring us to a cognitive destination in 2 minutes that requires sometimes 20 years to return from. Do you get me, beloved? You can embark on a journey. It takes you 2 minutes to get there. You can engage in a thing. It takes you 2 minutes to do it. But it takes you 20 years to recover from it. So be very careful of the paths you allow your mind, your emotions, your soul to go down. Because every journey is not yours to take. This is Andre Knight with the word of life for your soul. God's blessings and peace be upon you.
I heard the voice of Jesus say, come unto me and rest. Thy weary one, lay down thy head upon my breast. I came to Jesus as I was weary and worn and sad. I found in him a resting place, and he has made me glad. I heard the